In your inner ear, you have another system called the vestibular sense. This sense is for balancing. So in your inner ear, 50% part cochlea, that's for auditory. The other 50% is for balancing. The semicircular canal, that's three tubes. These three tubes are like in the X, Y, and Z direction. So no matter which direction your ear move, and you're gonna vibrate them. And that's for balancing. So inside, they still have hair cells, but this is not the endolymph. This is called the otolith. Otolith is a crystal, it's like a salt. Otolith is mainly made of calcium. And when you move your head, move your body, and this otolith is gonna move. And when they move, they're able to pull the hair, and you are able to sense the balancing. So together, the inner ear, you have 50% part auditory, 50% part balancing. So together, they go to the cranial nerve number 8, vestibular cochlea, and they will send the signal to your brain. For the vestibular part, it's more difficult to perceive it because that's the system you never appreciated. You took it for granted until you lose it. And we do have people, they damage their inner ear, but their auditory system is fine, and they could not balance. So that's because of this part. 50% of your inner ear is balancing. And when we look at the equilibrium pathway, okay, from your equilibrium systems for balancing, they go to your brain. A lot of them, you found, they go to not your cortex. A small portion go to your cortex, but the big output, see, they go to your cerebellum. And what's the function of cerebellum? Balancing. It will go to coordinate your eyes. So your eyes, outside you have 6 muscles, 3 pairs of muscle, and they're controlled by cranial nerve number 3, 4, and 6. They control your eye movement, because when your body are moving, think about you're taking the boat, you're constantly moving, or you're in a bus, you're constantly moving. You need to coordinate your eyes so you feel balanced. And when this part is damaged, also it will go to the vestibular spinal tract. It will go to control your muscles so you can maintain balance in a constant moving bus or constant moving boat. And because of this, some people, they damage their inner ear. They are very inconvenient. They feel like it's very inconvenient for their life because suddenly they could not take the bus. In the bus, the bus always shaking. And they could not balance, they could not even stand because they have difficulty to coordinate this part, their muscle, their eye, they feel so dizzy. So for the vestibular system, a big output, this is a system we just took it for granted. They will talk a lot to the cerebellum, talk a lot to your eye, and talk a lot to your body muscle, so you are able to coordinate your body to balance. But okay, the last two, chemical senses. These two systems, we don't know them too well compared with the others we talk about. We know the visual, or that's the main system we know a lot. We know auditory, we know somatosensory. But these two chemical senses, some people they don't have it, and it's inconvenient, but they live with it. They live with it. Because these two systems, their main function is to entertaining your life. Give the flavor of the food. So let's look at the test first. Test is the test bud. So that's the sensor on your tongue. It's mainly on your tongue and pharynx, so in the throat. Sometimes, especially the bitter flavor. So sometimes you take the medicine, it got stuck in your throat and you feel, oh, it's bitter. The bitter flavor, because on the throat is mainly the bitter one. And the test bud, let's look at the test bud. You have 5 different flavors: sweet, sour, bitter, salty. That's the traditional one. Plus one, umami. Umami is a savory flavor. The meat broth, you have umami. And also, if you like sashimi, or anyone likes sashimi. Why it tastes so good? Because those fresh seafood has a lot of umami. It's glutamate. And also MSG. MSG is the artificial one. And they create a different kind of flavor. You don't have spicy. Spicy is pain receptor. If you like the spicy food, actually it activates the pain receptor. But eventually it's the combination of all the senses. plus the pain, plus the smell. Don't forget the smell. And they go to your brain, they enhance your flavor. And the signal transduction, okay, they're very similar, actually the same concept as signal transduction we learned in Unit 1. So you need to have the signal first messenger. And they need to trigger the depolarization or trigger the second messenger system in your cell. And this time it's the receptor. So let's look at each one of them, those traditional ones. Like the these two are easy to understand, the salty and the sour, the acid, right? So these two, the salty is salt, so sodium chloride. And the sodiums, they have the sodium channel. So for the salty flavor is when the sodium flow in, and they will open the ion channels, calcium channels. So both of them will depolarize. Deploys the cell. When it deploys, the cells release neurotransmitters, so that triggers the salty flavor. For the sour is acid, so that's the hydrogen. So they are able to open the hydrogen channel and cause the depolarization. So these two are ion. And for the sweet, so the salty and the sour, they use the ion channel. For the sweet, bitter, umami, and these are the chemical molecule, like umami is glutamate, and sweet, bitter, these are chemical molecules. They need to have a G-protein coupled receptor. And they still have the outside part, they bind with the signal, and the inside part, they will activate the G-protein, activate the second messenger, and don't even know what the second messenger is. Could be cyclic AMP or the other second messenger system, and eventually transduct the signal. That's how little we know about the flavor. And now let's look at the olfactory. Olfactory, we know a little bit more because in 2004 we have Nobel Prize winner. He studied olfactory, but still much less compared with the visual auditory. Olfactory is the chemical molecule, still chemical molecule. It go to the nose, and it will bite on the top part of your nasal cavity. So this explains when you get sick, you have a lot of mucus, all block this, and you don't smell the food, and you don't like to eat. Because the food need to taste good, the food also need to smell good. So the chemical molecule will flow into the nasal cavity. On the top part, upper part of the nasal cavity, you have those olfactory cells. So it will go through the olfactory bulb and go through the cranial nerve number 1 olfactory and go to your brain, go to your olfactory cortex. And these chemical signals, and every time you smell something, it's not one signal, it's several signals. So they will activate different receptor, and they will open the ion channel and cause the depolarization, eventually cause the neurotransmitter release, and they're able to transfer them to the action potential. So that's what the Nobel Prize winner in 2004 found. It's not one particle, it's a pattern. It's a pattern. Every time you smell something, it's a pattern. And this activation pattern will trigger the memory. So olfactory, you need memory because you smell steak before. So you know, oh, okay, the steak smells good. And that's the pattern. And if you change the pattern a little bit, sometimes you can smell actually, oh, the steak is overcooked. It's been burned. And just change a few patterns, you change the smell. The perfume company, they're really, really into it. They can change the pattern a little bit and create a pretty, pretty nice smelling perfume. Some people like it, other people don't like it. And it's all based on the pattern. So in human, these two chemical senses, their main function is flavor. In some animals, they have a bigger function, but in human, that's the flavor. And especially olfactory, that's the one they're going to go to the limbic system. So in your five senses, the only one can bypass thalamus. When we talk about the thalamus, I tell you thalamus is like a train station. All the information moving in, moving out of the cortex need to go through thalamus. The only exception, olfactory. It can directly bypass the thalamus and connect with the limbic system. And we talk about the limbic system. Limbic system function is memory, emotion-related memory. So think about how many people, how many artists, they wrote songs, the novels, talk about the smell, trigger memory, old memory. And they don't know why. That's the neurophysiological explanation. Because it will go to the olfactory system trigger the memory. And that's when you and your friend, you walk in a mall, you smell the food, and suddenly you stop and you say, oh, my grandma used to make this kind of food. And those old memories, years, sometimes decades, memories come back, because olfactory is a big, big trigger of memory, especially old emotional related memory. And in some animals, the chemical sense become their main sensory system, like this little guy. Right? For the mice, they're nocturnal. And if you give them a expensive digital camera and say, Merry Christmas, this is a very good digital camera, and they will tell you, okay, this is useless to me, because when they come out, there's no light. So it makes no sense for their brain dedicated to the visual system. So in your brain, this is the sagittal section, this is the olfactory bulb, this is the cortex. Well, olfactory bulb, almost half the size of the cortex. That's how important the olfactory system is. And that's the mice brain. See how smooth their cortex is? So you want to have a lot of wrinkle in your cortex, because you can put more neurons in and make you smarter. And their olfactory system, that's their main system. And they have it become not just to find the food, also for their social communication. It's a pheromone system. Pheromone is a very unique one. Some textbooks put it into the hormone, others don't. Because the traditional definition of hormone is it need to be carried by blood. And the pheromone is in the air. And these rodents, their menstrual cycle is 4 days. So every 4 days, the female is going to ovulate. And if they got pregnant, it takes about 3 weeks and to give birth. Every time they give birth, it's a liter of 10 to 15 pups. And it takes them about 2 months to fully mature, and they can reproduce. But when they are 35 days, they can sexually produce. So if you imagine how many they can reproduce. And they are nocturnal, so it's difficult for them to find mate, and they use the pheromone system, the chemical. So when the female is ovulating, and it's like the hormone, very low dosage can trigger a big effect, and they can smell it, and they're able to find the pheromone. Do humans have pheromone? Some scientists believe humans have pheromone, but this is not our main system, so turn out we don't put it obviously. Can sense it. And there's some studies they found humans have the pheromone system, and perfume company is really into it. Imagine you can wear a perfume and the pheromone, and well, it's worth the money. And actually, some perfumes company claim they add the pheromone to their perfume, but apparently this is not our main system. Okay, so there's the chemical senses, and let's stop here.